Hello everyone, good afternoon. This is Lorna Lucas. I'm part of the education team here at the Association of Community Cancer Centers. And I want to thank you all for joining us for today's webinar on psychosocial support and financial counseling, multiple myeloma, as part of the ACCC's transplant treatment path, optimizing patient-centered care for ASCT and multiple myeloma. It's an ACCC educational initiative aimed at improving provider communication to optimize the treatment of multiple myeloma patients in the community cancer center pre and post autologous stem cell transplant, or often known as ASCT. Financial support for the webinar is provided by Celgene, and this webinar will be presented by Dr. Jo Kim and will feature Alice Mullins, oncology social worker at Winship Cancer Institute of Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia. I just want to point out a couple of reminders for today's webinar. If you look at your webinar screen, you will notice that there's a questions text box located in the lower right portion. This is where you may ask the presenter questions throughout the presentation. Just type your question in the box, click the send button, and we will collect all the questions, and Dr. Kim will have Ms. Mullins answer them during the question and answer portion at the end of the program. Please also note there will be an email sent to all registrants within the next few business days, advising where to access the archive for the webinar, as well as a link to the slide deck. At this time, I will go ahead and turn the session over to Dr. Kim.
Great. Thank you very much, Lorna, and it's a pleasure to be here. I want to thank Alice for joining me as well. And as we share with you the lessons learned from this project, there's clearly some background information and things like that that we'll review, but then also we really do want to invite your participation to share, and you know, please share your questions as we go through this presentation. So just to provide a little bit of background in terms of how we got to this project, the project was really aimed at improving communication, the treatment pathway when patients are being referred for stem cell transplant from the community setting to these larger academic tertiary care transplant centers. And so as part of this, ACCC identified an advisory committee, we recruited sites, we actually went on site to these transplant centers and conducted very thorough and comprehensive interactive workshops to discuss the process of communication, care coordination, documentation, just all of the different issues. The goal was really to identify some key opportunities for both process and communication improvements so that the lessons learned could be applicable to a broad range of ACCC members, ranging from the smaller to mid-sized, you know, community oncology practices that are referring these patients for transplant, as well as for the transplant centers out there that are receiving these patients who are being referred to them. And so that was really the ultimate goal. This project, as Lorna mentioned, was supported by Celgene, and we also had BMT InfoNet on board as a partner in this initiative. In terms of the participating organizations, you can see here that we went out to Emory, as well as GW, Seattle Cancer Care Alliance, and Ohio State University. Those were the four transplant centers that participated in these workshops. We actually went on site, and we invited people from a few of the referring practices in those regions to come in and share and to talk about their experiences, what was happening as these patients were being referred for transplant, and then going back ultimately back to these referring practices for both long-term follow-up care, co-management, and those kinds of things. And given that Alice is here on the line from Emory, Alice, if you could just spend a few minutes and just share with us, you know, what is your role within the organization, broadly speaking, and then what role do you play as it relates to these transplant patients who undergo, who have multiple myeloma?
Thank you, Dr. Kim. My role as a social worker basically is to help patients navigate their way to have a transplant successfully in terms of the psychosocial aspects. So it can range from dealing with some of the financial challenges to psychosocial challenges with maybe distress, transportation, lodging, the logistics of having a transplant. I will normally get involved at the beginning process when they are referred initially to our center. Usually the first visit, we try and meet with all of the patients who are coming to have a transplant.
Great. Thanks very much. And we'll be talking more about your role, what happens within your organization, and we'll also be talking about what we learned from some of these other groups as well, given that some of these centers do transplants for multiple myeloma as an inpatient versus an outpatient, and then also the various geography issues. You mentioned things like transportation, parking, housing logistics, and so we'll be getting into some of those details. Just to move on here, we're on slide number 4, and we're talking about some of the referring practices and transplant centers who responded to the ACCC Needs Assessment Survey, because this is really the first step in this whole initiative to understand what some of the strengths, the challenges, as well as key opportunities for improvement out there in the community. And the referring practices certainly felt that their team of physicians, the volume of myeloma patients that they were treating were some of their strengths. The transplant centers, of course, recognize the value of the multidisciplinary team approach, expertise in myeloma, as well as the access to clinical trials. And we spent a lot of time talking about how to improve clinical trial enrollment throughout this initiative as well. The key challenges, I think, were universal in terms of things like recognizing treatment toxicities, patient adherence to treatment regimens and follow-up, as well as the logistical, financial, and other barriers, sort of the psychosocial issues that we'll be getting into throughout this presentation today. And then as we identified the needs for improvement, we identified some specific to the referring practices, some that are specific to the transplant centers, and clearly there are overlapping themes. You know, better communication, they both agreed that this was needed on both ends. There was still a lot of faxing of documents, and so, you know, we talked about, are there ways to improve efficiencies to reduce the use of faxing, and then, of course, things like patient education, the need for instructions and guidance along the way. So there were a lot of different ideas that certainly emerged and surfaced, and we'll be sharing those as well. As a reminder to the audience, you know, this is one of three webinars on this front, reflecting some of the findings from this project, and although, you know, today's webinar is going to focus on the psychosocial components, there will certainly be overlapping themes with some of the other lessons learned, and so we invite everyone today to participate in the future webinars that have been scheduled as well. So moving on to slide number 5, just a real brief reminder for everyone about the CMS quality strategy goals, because we wanted to reflect on what is impacting the nation today and what is most relevant for people working both in the outpatient setting as well as those in these larger tertiary care settings. And you'll see that even, you know, when we look at this diagram, there are clearly needs to just foster and improve things like care coordination. So number 3 on the bottom, promote effective communication and coordination of care. Number 4, promote effective prevention and treatment of chronic disease. And then number 5, work with communities to promote better practices of heavy living. And we really felt that when it focused around communication, the coordination of care, this is really an area where there are still opportunities for improvement. There are many organizations still struggling with health information technology and just the use of that, as well as patient records and just the transportation of those records, whether it's via paper or electronically or through U.S. Postal Service, FedEx, UPS, and so forth. So we did design the initiative around these goals in mind. And then on slide number 6, just going back to that survey, in terms, we wanted to really understand what are some of the reasons why patients who might be referred for transplant, some of these multiple myeloma patients, don't ultimately undergo transplant. And the respondents to this survey mentioned things like lack of insurance coverage, financial barriers, the psychosocial reasons, the lack of support, the patient preference, comorbidities, and so on. I think one of the key lessons that we learned when we went to these centers and discussed the way that they even bring up the topic of transplant and educate and guide patients about their treatment options revolves around the use or the need for a caregiver, and just making sure that they are aware that they need a caregiver as they go through this journey. Alice, in your experience, are patients, when they come to your transplant center, at that point, do most of them have a caregiver identified and at least one or two of them who are ready to sort of work with them? Or at that point, are they still in the process of trying to figure out who that caregiver or caregivers can be?
Most of the time, they're still in the process of identifying caregivers. Usually, if there's a spouse involved or brothers and sisters, siblings who are very involved and close by with the patient, then that's an easier fit where they're already thinking about caregiving. But a lot of them are still trying to find out who could be a caregiver, especially when we're talking about maybe somebody is working and not understanding how to navigate getting off of work and the time that it's going to take to be a caregiver.
Sure. No, it's a great point. And the other thing that we have found in our experience, too, by once again traveling and visiting with these centers and talking with them, is that when they're first referred for transplant, and they may be told at that time you're going to need to find a caregiver, they don't necessarily know, well, what are the roles and responsibilities for this caregiver? And then when they come to the transplant center like yours and they're provided a lot more details and instructions, then at least they have a much better understanding of what those caregiver responsibilities are. And we've also heard from some patients that they actually will come with their caregiver to those initial set of meetings at the transplant center. So has that been your experience as well, where some of them really try to bring their caregivers with them if they're not family members?
Yes, they do. And it's a great time if they're coming with them. We like to encourage them to continue to come so that they have another set of eyes and ears in this process. And because sometimes the patients may hear one thing and get stopped, whereas the caregiver having that second ears and eyes, they can ask questions and still continue the conversation and be able to recall later on with the patient what decisions have been made. So they
sure
do try.
Yeah, no, that's great. So moving on now to slide number 7, the growing burden of out-of-pocket costs. You know, ACCC has an entire initiative focused around financial advocacy and navigation. And I would say that multiple myeloma is one of those areas where there seems to just be an increased burden financially on a number of these patients, especially if they're referred for transplant. But even if they're not, there are different issues related to the therapies, the medications, and if they require ongoing maintenance therapies. This is just one study that was done back in 2010 that just talks about out-of-pocket costs for patients, for cancer patients, in terms of their willingness and their ability to continue with adherence. And when those out-of-pocket costs exceeded $200, they were 3 times more likely not to refill than if those out-of-pocket costs were $100 or less. And I think in the broader scheme of this whole initiative, we definitely spent a lot of time discussing how better to provide the financial navigation support services for these patients. And so we'll be spending a little bit more talking about that. Just moving on now to slide number 7, the Cancer Experience Registry was another report where they surveyed patients both with solid tumors and some hematologic malignancies. And the question here was, you know, they wanted to ask from patients, you know, because of the medical cost of cancer, I have, and then you'll see that a significant percentage have said things like, I'm going to forego vacations, I'm going to cut on some of my expenses. You know, about a third of them said that. Many of them reported that they were tapping into pharmaceutical assistance programs, as well as borrowing money from their savings. So we know that the financial toxicity component is a significant element that must be addressed. And ideally, the sooner we address it, the more effectively patients can be navigated through this process. So moving on to slide number 9, you know, in terms of assessing these patients and their readiness for transplant, what we found was that there were several different initiatives and projects within some of these organizations just focusing on this topic, looking at the whole picture from psychosocial support, the financial, the medical, and so on and so forth. And from a psychosocial support, you know, we found that these were some of the key issues that patients needed to be thinking about when they were at least being referred for transplant, preparing for that first meeting, traveling to the transplant center, sitting in on some of those initial meetings, discussions, and conversations, as well as educational meetings if they are being held. And we talked about some of these things, like the role of family and friends, as well as support groups. And then, of course, the financial considerations that we just discussed, things from even the cost of transportation and parking and lodging, all the way through to their actual medical expenses and out-of-pocket costs. So Alice, I guess in your program, tell us what kinds of steps you all do to assess the readiness of a patient to undergo transplant when they're initially referred to you.
So initially when they're referred, it's going to start with our referral intake office, and we'll start assessing in terms of the insurance piece and whether patients have insurance or not. And so when someone's identified as having insurance other than Medicare and Medicaid, they will get referred to, we have a specific BMT financial coordinator who will handle those insurances to verify the insurance. They'll also verify certain medications to see if they're covered or need prior authorization. And the uninsured patients then also will then be referred to. We have a company who will help to identify and assist those patients with Social Security, Medicaid, ACA, eligibility, and applications. And then also the BMT financial coordinator will help to the patients to understand their insurance plans and their out-of-pocket costs at that point. So that's the initial piece. So we're already starting to work on those financial challenges, getting patients aware of what's going on. And then when they meet with the physician, they'll also meet with me, and I will start to see, okay, so let's look at their social situation. Let's see, are they living close? Do they have, what's their support network like? Looking at, are they working, or have they applied for disability yet? And just trying to assess, okay, how much of a role they have, how people of being in the system with them in terms of their family or friends, even coworkers, and how they'll be able to help them in this process.
Sure. And clearly, you know, Emory is a large transplant center, and Atlanta is a big city. What percentage of the patients who are referred for transplant would you say end up needing to secure housing because they're driving or traveling from a long distance?
Oh, that's a good question.
If you were just to guess.
I would say a large percentage, probably about 50 to 60%, because with Atlanta being such a large city, the traffic here will take a long time, even if it's just 30 miles. So we are really having to use like the American Cancer Society Hope Lodge, the Atlanta Hospital Hospitality House, and just hotels in the area to help those patients.
Okay, yeah, and we've heard similar things as well, particularly for these centers where, you know, they know the significant percentage of patients travel and need overnight housing and everything. So, well, let's move on, and this next slide here talks about the financial navigation sort of roadmap and pathway that various organizations have, and it sounds like within your organization, it's really that BMT financial coordinator who does a lot of the information gathering. So at Emory, this BMT financial coordinator gets all that information over the phone, is that right?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, and then does that information get communicated to you or other members of the care team before the patient's seen by the physician?
Yes, usually she will send out a report just detailing the information in terms of speaking with the insurance company, also speaking with the patient. She'll even identify sometimes caregivers in that process.
Okay. And then along this pathway, there are clearly patients who need things like pharmaceutical assistance, or in some cases they may go and tap into some disease foundations for assistance programs. Once again, is it the BMT financial coordinator who does a lot of that, or is that role shared with you or with other members of the team?
The treatment medications are handled by another person, and then the assistance programs with dealing with the other medications, the supportive medications, that's something that we handle in terms of the social workers handle for copay assistance programs.
Okay, so it really is a team-based approach as you're sort of walking through and thinking about the different financial needs and opportunities for assistance for each patient then.
Yes.
Okay, great. So, you know, we reflect on this sort of, once again, pathway, thinking about as we've gone to different organizations, everyone has a different process. They've got different members of the care team. And I would encourage those on the webinar to just consider for your organization, you know, who do you all have doing these various roles and responsibilities, and how is it a team-based approach versus more individualized approach? So moving on, to the next slide here, you know, we talked about common gaps and breakdowns that we found along the way. I think a big one that was sort of a common theme was that many of these patients who are being referred for transplant are just simply unaware of the different kinds of assistance programs that do exist. Perhaps it partly because their assumption is that their insurance is just going to cover it, or it's their insurance combined with their out-of-pocket costs. So a big part of this was just making patients aware that the assistance programs were available and that it wasn't only for Medicaid or for uninsured, but rather for a broad group of people. And part of the reason why this is also prevalent was that many of these organizations, both referring practices and transplant centers, we're not necessarily identifying patients who are underinsured. Now, we know that because of healthcare reform, we have a much smaller group of uninsured patients in this country, but many organizations have reported that their underinsured patients seem to be growing. The patients who have, you know, who are on these plans where out-of-pocket costs are increasing, deductibles are increasing, and so it's just making it more difficult for them to afford the care that they need. And of course, this sort of ties into this next bullet of how patients are often underestimating their total obligation. So I guess as it relates to these kinds of things, Alice, within your organization, what would you say are the steps of really trying to assess whether or not a patient is potentially underinsured? Is that really something that the BMT financial coordinator does through some kind of a structured assessment, or is it, like, how is that process done within Emory?
The BMT financial coordinator, she will discuss in terms of pricing estimate, and we'll be able to find out exactly kind of how much the treatment is going to cost for the patient. And so that gives the patient a sense of what's going on, and even being able to discuss with the patient, because like you said, sometimes they just don't understand how much out of pocket means. And then when it comes to being realistic about the transportation piece or about parking, about gas, all of those things, not understanding that adds into the cost. And sometimes patients do have some insurances that will pay for travel, will pay for lodging, but they don't actually know that either. And so our financial coordinator will be able to let them know, you know, you have these resources also. You just need to contact your insurance company so that they can get, you can get reimbursement for them.
Exactly. Yeah, I think that point about, you know, even the assistance programs for the non-medical expenses like travel, lodging, housing, and such, many patients we found were unaware of those kinds of programs out there. Mm-hmm. And so it's great that you're bringing those up. So moving on to slide number 12 and really 13, the next one, you know, these were just a few examples that we showed and we talked about when we went out and conducted our workshops, that there are useful tools that are available through the government and other resources that really help explain terminology that patients often misunderstand, you know, terminology like deductibles and co-pays. And here on slide 13, it even shows them a schematic of how deductible, co-insurance, out-of-pocket limits, you know, how does that ultimately end up impacting the patient based on the kind of coverage that, you know, he or she has. And there have been other studies and surveys that have shown that even the average adult living in America really has a difficult time understanding what these terms really mean. So when they get all their insurance paperwork, and yes, you verify their benefits, and they see these numbers, and they see the information on this sheet, it's difficult for many of them to really understand what it actually translates to on a practical level. So we encourage a lot of organizations to consider reviewing how they're educating patients about health insurance coverage, what kinds of tools they're using, are they using things like these visuals to help patients understand. And we spent a fair bit of time just making sure that patients gain a better understanding so that even when they receive their medical bill, they're not surprised with the kinds of things that they're hit with. Slide 14 talks about this tool called COST, the Comprehensive Score for Financial Toxicity, that was developed by the University of Chicago. And it's the first oncology-specific financial patient-reported outcome measure. It's a structured assessment tool, and this next slide shows you the 11 questions. Now, one thing that you'll notice about these 11 questions is that it's not a simple yes or no. They actually have the patient's rank and rate from 0 to 4, 0 being not at all, 4 being very much. And I think the reason that this tool is a useful and helpful example to many organizations is that we found that there were a number of oncology groups and hospitals and practices that had some kind of a psychosocial financial screening assessment. It might be a paper-based form or some kind of tool. And in many cases, it's simply a yes or no. Do you think you will need financial assistance? You know, yes or no. And what we found is that many patients may not necessarily know how to answer that. You know, they might think that, oh, well, because I have insurance, I should be okay. And yet this tool gets into a little bit more of in-depth information to really assess where patients are and what they're thinking. And then just moving on to this next slide here on slide 16, we know that there have been some recent studies. In fact, this was just published just a few months ago from the University of Pennsylvania, where it showed that patients with multiple myeloma may actually be much more vulnerable to financial toxicity because of things like the longer courses of treatment, the fact that many of these are expensive. And 17% of these patients reported delays in treatment due to cost, while you know, almost 60% reported that the costs were much higher than they had anticipated. So I think it just kind of reminds us that this toxicity issue is very important. And this next slide here talks about an idea. This is just really being presented really more as an idea that, you know, what would happen if we were to grade the financial toxicity for each patient, similar to the way that we grade side effects like mucositis or nausea, vomiting, fatigue, and we actually put that information in the patient's chart. So we might say that, you know, this patient has grade 3 financial toxicity, whereas this other patient has grade 4 financial toxicity. You know, would that change the kinds of conversations that occur? Would that change the dialogue that's happening within the team? So I guess on this comment, Alice, within your organization, I know that it's largely a team-based approach, but of course Emory is also a really large institution. How does the information about a patient's financial status and their risk of financial toxicity, how's that information communicated to all the members of the care team, you know, from the physicians to the nurses and others? Can you share with us how that happens?
Most of the time it's an in-person or a phone call or a team meeting that we have to discuss, especially if something is very much in terms of preventing them from moving forward if we see something that's going to cause them to be delayed. We do have team meetings regularly to where we're discussing what's going on with the patients, and so it's usually sent that way and not usually put in a patient's chart medically. It's more so wanting us to make sure what's going on so that we can best support the patient and see what we can do to help them get the treatment that they need.
Sure. Okay, great. And yeah, we're hearing more and more that these kinds of team meetings and just having more of these conversations are, you know, increasingly important in the community setting. So it's great to hear. Let me just share quickly about some of the ACCC Financial Advocacy Network resources that are currently available. So those of you on the webinar may be familiar with this program and the various tools that are available on the ACCC website. This is just a screenshot here on slide 18 that just shows you what's available. One of the probably most widely used tools is the Patient Assistance and Reimbursement Guide, which you can see there on the lower corner. And this is a guide that's updated twice a year and is now available as a mobile application as well. On the next slide here lists some of the toolkit elements, things like the financial advocate roles and responsibilities, tracking financial savings, you know, filing claims and dealing with denials and appeals and so forth. So for those on the webinar who are maybe not as familiar with what ACCC has to offer related to financial advocacy, we really encourage you to visit this section of the website and learn more and use these tools within your organization. So moving on to this next slide, you know, I think one of the key lessons learned, especially around the financial component, is that there are so many options and opportunities and it requires a lot of care coordination, and we've talked a lot about that. If you've got the robust team that can handle this and deal with it well, you know, if you've got a financial coordinator, a social worker, others who can all work collectively and help communicate and sort of guide patients along the way, then it really helps that patient throughout this journey. But we also see, based on this diagram, that to have one person filling out things like Social Security disability applications, or filling out the charity care, the philanthropic funds, the assistance programs, it's a lot of time. It's a lot of work. And so just once again, for the people on the webinar, to think about your team and how these roles are and responsibilities are divided, and how better to maybe either segment or, you know, if you need to grow your team, you know, those are all things to consider as well. So moving on to slide number 21, another topic that came up was just about the importance of support groups. And when we were at GW visiting with them and talking with their group, you know, they mentioned that they hold a monthly support group for multiple myeloma patients, family members, survivors. And this was a monthly meeting where these patients would actually share a lot of stories, give support, but also offer practical suggestions on how they kind of went through their journey. Alice, at Emory, what kind of support groups do you all offer?
I actually facilitate the multiple myeloma support group once a month. It includes patients and caregivers. At times, I will separate to where I just have the patients there to give them a chance to be able to talk on their own, things that they may not want to share with their caregivers and how they're feeling. And I do also refer, we also have community myeloma support groups that I refer to that I've worked with, and they're a great resource also. We also have a peer partners program to do one-on-one peer support. Someone who's gone through treatment, someone who's gone through transplant, and can speak to someone about their journey.
Now, the support groups that you all hold, is it primarily just in a live setting like a room, or are things done using either telephone or any kind of telecommunication technologies?
Not yet. It's just in a live group. It's just in a live setting here at the Winship.
Okay. So we are hearing more and more about the importance of these kinds of things, and it's great to hear what you all have going on. Tell us a little bit more about these peer, you know, the peer partners and sort of that individualized support. What do they offer?
Well, what it is, it's more telephone support, even though sometimes we do have some peer partners who will meet with people down in the infusion center. But we have people who go through a training that that we offer. And they'll be first assessed. They'll want to volunteer. They'll go through an assessment process, you know, making sure that they're appropriate in terms of sharing with patients of what's going on in their journey, and training them. And then they will contact someone who wanted a peer partner, and will contact the person who is a peer partner to see if they're available. And then we match them. And then they just talk, and we'll get a report back from the peer partner, if how long they've spoken with the patient, kind of the gist of what the conversation was about, and if there's any red flags, if there's anything that we need to follow up on to help the patient. But we've gotten great feedback from our patients who have utilized this program.
Okay, great. Wonderful. So just moving on now to just, you know, we're getting near the end, and those of you who have submitted questions, we will get to as many of them as we can at the very end. So thank you, and if you have not submitted your questions, you know, please do so. But, you know, the framework that we used to really model the quality improvement at these workshops was the Institute for Healthcare Improvement's, you know, Plan, Do, Study, Act cycle, which is the model that the IHI uses as a simple framework, and this model is certainly used in other industries as well. Some people call it the Plan, Do, Check Act, so PDCA cycle, and it's a very simple framework where you have to identify an idea for improvement, and then you carry it out and you study the impact that it had, and if it achieved what you thought it was going to, then at that point you can scale it out to a broader scale and make bigger improvements. And it's really a process-driven improvement. So this is the actual PDSA worksheet that we had centers fill out. And once again, you'll see that it's a structured document where you have to be very specific about what is that aim that you want to improve, assign responsibilities, assign milestone dates, as well as times when you're going to follow up to see, you know, did it actually change things? And some of the ideas that came out of the discussions that we held focused around even just processes of communication. You know, when something needs to be sent to a different group, like the transplant center sending a report back to the referring practice. You know, is it sufficient to just wait for the entire discharge summary, or do they try to summarize that into one pager and then send that immediately? And so we discussed and brainstormed a number of different process improvement ideas ranging across these different topics, but we used this as really the framework to assess whether or not the impact of these interventions were beneficial. So once again, within your organization, if you're not using quality improvement methodologies like PDSA, or there's clearly others like Lean and Six Sigma, some that are much more robust. You know, these are very basic methods that you can start incorporating to just adopt that culture of continuous quality improvement within your organization. So, you know, as I mentioned earlier, and we're now on this last slide just kind of wrapping up, and then we will get to your questions, there will be some other webinars from this project where we're going to be able to take some of the lessons learned, share that with the broader community. And then within the ACCC's website as well, there is a resource center dedicated to multiple myeloma where you will also find some written materials and other things, including the transplant treatment path, which is a communication guide. It's going to be mailed out with your November-December oncology issues, but it's also available on the ACCC website as well. You know, this project certainly brought together different kinds of teams into the conversation. You know, when you've got the dynamics occurring within a community-based outpatient oncology practice and the different workflows that are happening there, as well as within a large tertiary care academic, you know, research NCI-driven cancer center, and you bring those two groups together, what we found was that these teams can ultimately identify opportunities and prioritize what is going to have the greatest impact in terms of improving communication and workflow, improving care coordination. And as we discussed different ideas and sort of brainstormed them, wrote them up on a whiteboard, and allowed the teams to agree, yeah, we believe that this change would really impact our patients, or, you know, this other change might not be feasible because of the kinds of either staffing infrastructures or resources that we have at our disposal. So we were able to really spend some time discussing that. And as we followed up with these organizations as well, we found that the discussion in and of itself was helpful, but also those improvement ideas that they then took and started implementing within their organizations also allowed them to embrace a culture of ongoing and continuous improvement. Some of the lessons learned, I know, specific from Emory and their referring practices was really just to make it more to improve overall communication with the transplant physicians at Emory, with the referring physicians in the community, as well as to make sure that the referring physicians were more aware of things like the various clinical trials and clinical trial enrollment opportunities. And we'll be spending some more time talking about some of those things in future webinars. So let's get to some of the questions that came in. And, you know, one of the questions that came in was regarding the cost of lodging. And, you know, we talked earlier about some of the various assistance programs out there. And Alice, I'm just wondering if you can mention, you know, when it comes to lodging, you mentioned a few specific examples like the Hope Lodge and the various hospitality resources in Atlanta. Where does the assistance for the cost for the lodging come from?
Outside of the Hope Lodge, which is free, and the hospitality house, which is $20 a night, really it comes from the patient. It's an out-of-pocket expense. And so when I'm talking with patients initially, I start from the beginning in terms of talking about fundraising and really using fundraising, using organizations that do fundraising, like the Bone Marrow Foundation, that will set up websites to reach out to not just the people who are local to you, but the people who are outside your community, your circle of friends touching their circle of friends, and having to go about it that way. But it is an out-of-pocket expense.
Mm-hmm. And on the topic of fundraising, have you found that patients have been successful using some of these online fundraising platforms like GoFundMe and others like that?
I have heard some. I encourage patients to, they can do the GoFundMe. I encourage patients to look at some that are something like the Bone Marrow Foundation also, because when the benefit of that one is for the people who are donating, they also, it's tax deductible. So it's also an incentive. And but GoFundMe is fine, but yes, I have had success. People have had success with fundraising through those arenas.
Okay, great. Another question that came up is just around the use of structured patient education materials. What kind of, what is your process of educating patients during their initial visits when they are referred for transplant? What kinds of materials do they receive from Emory?
So they will receive initially, of course, things about the diagnosis. From the psychosocial aspect, we give them information on just the fundraising. We give them information on our financial coordinators and how to reach them. We also give them information starting on some copay assistance programs, also some drug assistance websites to check out initially. And then when they go, when we're heading more towards evaluation, we give even more. If we haven't spoken with them yet, we give them even more, even a whole list of organizations that help manage financial challenges.
So it sounds like it's a fair bit of material. Does it come in a binder or in a booklet, or is it just a bunch of handouts, or how do you sort of package and deliver this to the patient?
For our myeloma patients, they usually get a binder to begin with, and I do encourage patients to actually get binders anyway. But for us and what social services gives out, I now do color-coordinated handouts because white sheets get lost in the process of everything. So with ours, they're just some handouts, but they are color-coordinated so I can have them easily refer to them.
Okay, great. Another question that came up is just regarding your initial referral, the intake office, and how patients are sent to the BMT financial coordinator. So is that the patient who calls in? Is it the referring practice who sort of calls in and sets up that initial intake? Like, who is the one coordinating that initial referral, and how's that information obtained from your end?
I think it comes both ways. We have physicians who will refer, and their offices will call the intake office. But we also have some patients who will self-refer. When they do self-refer, we do have the intake referral office will contact their referring physician, though, also to get information, medical records, and all of that before they come into their consult visit.
Mm-hmm. So when the referring practice is the one making the referral, there, are they also the ones answering all the insurance coverage questions since they already have that information on the patient?
Repeat the question for me.
So when the referring practice refers the patient into your intake office, are they also the ones answering the questions about the patient's insurance coverage?
No. That will go to the BMT financial coordinator. They will call and speak with the patient.
Patient directly. Okay.
Yes.
All right. So just thank you for that clarification. Another question that came up is regarding the psychosocial support that's needed for the patient after the patient completes transplant and goes back into the community. How is that coordinated with the referring practice, that sort of primary oncologist when the patient goes back?
It really depends. Because a lot of times we're having patients still come back and forth, maybe once every 6 months. Once they're our patient, they're our patient. And so I will assist in any way that I can. If it's something that's going on where they need that support in the community, what I do is I'll see if there's anyone. I may talk to the referring physician's office, but most likely I'm going to try and identify what resources are available in their community and point them to that direction.
Okay, great. Well, we are out of time. I want to thank Els again for joining us. I want to also remind everyone on the webinar that, you know, on the ACCC's website under Provider Resources, you can find the Transplant Treatment Path, which is a communication guide. It will be mailed out with the November-December issue of Oncology Issues. And like I said, it's available as an online download as well. But at this point, I want to turn it back to Lorna so that she can wrap up.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Kim and Ms. Mullins, for providing a wonderful presentation. And thank you all for participating and attending the webinar today. As mentioned before, we will make the presentation slides available online as well as the archived version of the webinar. So that should be up online in a few days. And we will email all registrants from the webinar with the link to access that. And again, feel free to check out all of the resources on ACCC's website, like Dr. Kim mentioned, and that is ACCC, so ACCC-cancer.org. Thank you so much, and have a great rest of the week.